Okay, we're going to get started. I'd like to welcome everyone for joining us tonight for the second York Sports Forum. I want to thank those who are prepared to ask questions tonight and those who submitted questions in advance of tonight's forum. Before we get into it, I'd like to introduce those who are with me here tonight. I'm Lou Gosensky, Superintendent of Schools. Joining us tonight is Kyle Francis, the principal at the York High School. Jeff Oliver, our athletic director, and Anita Bernhardt, our assistant superintendent, who will be fielding questions. Anita, can you just tell folks how they can get questions to you?
Absolutely. So we're going to collect questions from the public the same way that we do at our school committee meetings. So you can call into 363-3403. Extension 10016, and then what you'll do is leave a message on that voicemail, and I will be able to pick it up, and I will relay the comment question that you have for the group. Thanks. Again, that's 363-3403, extension 10016.
Thanks, Anita. I also want to recognize Patrick Robb, who's working behind the scenes, who assists us in putting forward the forums as well as connecting us to live stream. So thank you, Patrick Robb. So before we begin, I just want to remind folks that since the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, all of my decisions as superintendent, first and foremost, have been predicated on the health and safety of our students and our community. I also want to acknowledge that sports does play a significant and important role in the mental and physical health of our students. There is no doubt, and I don't disagree with that at all. It is a part of the school experience. Please understand that the fluidity of COVID-19 situation in New York schools in the region and in the state means that we are continually engaged in discussions in school and outside in our communities. We are not waiting for herd immunity or mass access to vaccinations to open avenues for students to engage in activities. We are actively working to create new opportunities for safe sports and other interactive activities for our students. The decisions that the York School Department makes regarding sports impact many of our students. This is why we are here tonight and why I want to be sure we've had the chance to hear from all of you. So with that said, I want to thank you again for joining us tonight, and I'm going to turn this over to Jeff Oliver, who's going to give you some updates and some information relative to our athletic programs. Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah, thank you, Lou. I really just wanted to go over what we're currently doing right now. And currently, we are doing cohorted practices. So if a student's at school on Monday, they do have athletic opportunities after school on Monday to participate within their cohort. Students have done pretty well with that. I've done team talks with each of the programs. Of course, there's always a desire to get back to our normal operations, but certainly the activities we've been able to provide in the last couple of weeks have been significantly better than the virtual mode we were in before that. And before that, we were in a virtual mode based off of the color coding of yellow. The state currently requires that if you're in yellow, that athletics has to exist completely virtually. So getting out of that and being able to participate face-to-face has been great and a really much needed experience for our students who have been, completely virtual in athletics since March. So the second week we went into scrimmages within cohorts, and going forward, our goal will continue to be to reevaluate where we're at as a school and where we're at with COVID really and the risk levels and how those change each week, and hopefully be able to continue to move towards activities as we all know they were before COVID.
Hey, Carl, do you want to add anything with regard to your perspective as the high school principal?
Well, what I'd like to add is that safety is our top priority, and our system has been designed around that. Having said that, we all love and appreciate the value athletics and activities and understand that it's critically important for students and the spirit of the school community. And absolutely, what we want to have happen is to get back to the normal of what we know and appreciate and what we feel and love and enjoy. And that we're working hard right now to look at those opportunities that exist in the current status of the state based on the COVID-19 pandemic. So we are working, looking at those opportunities and making decisions based on safety, but knowing that we want to get back to normal. Every inch that we can take forward in that direction, we absolutely would.
Right. And, you know, I wanted to, again, acknowledge the importance of sports and activities for so many of our students. Again, this is not what we expected or want, and we know how difficult this is for our students. There are a wide variety of opinions out there, and we're trying to do our best to make decisions for all students. So, Jeff, do you want to talk a little bit about the Q&A statements that were developed from some of the questions we received? It's in the agenda under Q&A. I don't know if you want to review that briefly.
Let me get myself off of mute. Yeah. We're good. So there was a Q&A that was sent out Friday afternoon, sent out to families at York High School. It kind of went over or documented how we got to where we're at now. It answered a variety of questions, some that we will probably get tonight. For example, what unique York circumstances have influenced this decision? The decision to have cohorted practices, and it kind of goes into our the fact that we are cohorted right now, and the student and family impact, and the teacher impact, and why are we cohorted in the school day. Also, part of that is the risk associated playing sports, and that came from the NPA and the state. Obviously, there are increased risks with athletic activities. That's why we're here and where we're at today. Without having, full sports as we know it, because of the increased risk. I do believe as time goes by that we'll continue to evaluate those risks and hopefully be able to provide more activities. State guidelines such as symptom screening, physical distance and masking, hand hygiene, those are all important in athletic activities or during the school day. An explanation on how we were able to offer a cross-country event. We did do a cross-country event last week, just like the week before. We ended up doing scrimmages within cohorts. We'll continue to try to advance our offerings. The cross-country event worked out for us because we were able to meet the standards of symptom screening, physical distance and masking, hand hygiene. And because of the individual nature of that sport and, there's not positions, we're able to keep the cohorts separate and still let them compete. So we do have some advantages with some sports that aren't shared in others, at this point in the current stage we're at.
Yeah, I wanted to mention I had an opportunity to attend the cross-country event, traveled up to Freeport and got to witness firsthand. I thought the school did a nice job of maintaining the guidelines. They spread the runners out. We had the runners go out in different cohort groups. I think there was a picture that appeared in the Seacoast Online that was a file photo. That's not how our students started out in that particular race. That's an old picture from last year. What I witnessed was something different. Students were lined up across a large field, spread out, and ran and kept socially distanced in that race. And hats off to those athletes that participated. We had two young women that finished in the top 10 in the girls race, and very proud of them. I had a chance to talk to the students. They were appreciative of the fact that we were there, and we were able to do it safely. And that's how we're going to proceed when it comes to the rest of this season and into the winter and also into the spring. So again, I'm going to mention we're not waiting for herd immunity, and we're not waiting for a total vaccine here to try to offer opportunities for our students, not only in athletics and activities. It's a dynamic and fluid situation, and we're doing the best we can to keep everybody safe. So with that said, I think we can go right to questions, I guess. Anita, do you have any questions coming in?
I do have one question for you, and it was shared with us by Kristen Nelson. Kristen wants to know if the school district has considered the idea of having students do virtual learning in order to participate, to compete and practice together. So if I understand that question correctly, would it be possible to have all of the athletes be remote learners or distance learners so that they could participate in sports?
Well, one other thing I wanted to mention, I didn't mention earlier, I'm reconvening our health and safety committee, the committee that was included a number of people, including physicians, nurses, other health practitioners, the town's health officer, staff, parent volunteers. We're reconvening that committee, and that's something we can certainly consider. There have been some schools, I think, in New Hampshire that told their athletes they could participate in athletics if they attended school remotely. There are some schools, particularly in New Hampshire, that are totally remote and they're offering in-person athletics. Although there are some schools that are taking criticism for that because parents want to see their young adults in school in person. So that's something that we're going to discuss. It's something we can consider. It present unique challenges in terms of the amount of staff we have available, particularly at the high school, to teach necessary courses. Carl, I don't want to put you on the spot, but can you weigh a little bit on that? Because it's a challenge in terms of depending on how many students we have remotely, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. First survey that went out, it was critical because we needed to gauge how many families were looking at being full-time distance learners. And from that response, we built a hybrid system. We built a hybrid system to address that specific need. And the system that we have in place now would not support a huge influx of additional numbers to be in a full-time distance learning model. So at this point, you know, based on the numbers that we had, to repeat myself, just to make sure I was clear, the system would not support a large number of folks moving from in-person to out-of-person to distance learning. And, you know, we value the in-person model, and, you know, we want to really take advantage of that as much as we possibly can. So we wouldn't be able to support it as of today.
But it's something that we can take a look at, and it's something I'm going to bring to the table when we meet with our committee. I believe it's on Thursday, if I have that correct, Anita. We're reconvening that group for Thursday. So another question, Anita?
Yes. Hold on. There were three of them. I'm going to give you two of them right now from John Gennaro. The first question, and I'll let you respond to it, and then I'll hop in with the next one, is how does the administration defend the statement that was made that the York School Department does not care what's going on in districts in other parts of the state? So I don't know if the individual has been listening to everything so far. Did you hear that?
Yes.
Let me give you the second one as well, and then I'll listen.
Oh, yeah.
Will Superintendent Gazinski publicly say that the only way to get back to normal for us to get back to normal is either normal status of playing games and that sort of thing is if that we had either have herd immunity or get a blue rating from the state?
Well, first of all, let me correct the blue rating. The blue rating was a question I received on the floor at a school committee meeting about when would school be back to normal. And I use blue as an example of us going back without any restrictions. Okay, that's what I was referring to there. In terms of herd immunity, I just said that we're going to look at plans. As long as we can operate safely, we don't need to wait for herd immunity. Nor do we need to wait for a vaccine. What we're going to look at is get input from other people, make our decisions based on what's best for all students, and we'll continue to plug along. As I said before, it's a dynamic situation. You know, today I just sent a letter out saying there was a case at the middle school. It varies from day to day. And 2 days from now, I could be looking at shutting the school down because we've had three coronavirus cases in one particular school. So it's gonna vary each and every day. So I can't say, you know, with certainty what next week's gonna look like, to be totally honest with you folks. It's based on the information we receive at the time, the information we receive from the CDC, what case is being presented, how many folks are infected or affected, I should say. As we saw at the high school, we had one case that impacted over 50 people. And that was related to, again, the CDC guidance that we must follow. We were told that 50 people were needed to quarantine. And I got a slew of questions about why do those kiddos need to quarantine? Why do those kiddos or staff members, if they test positive, why can't they come out of quarantine? I encourage anyone that's listening to call the CDC at 211 to get those specific answers. I'm being asked to interpret information from the CDC. I give it to you, and I'm just a messenger on that particular information. If you want specific answers to the reasons why we do what we do with regard to health and safety, then I suggest you call 211. So in terms of herd immunity, no, we're not going to wait for herd immunity. Nope, we're not going to wait for vaccines. I think that statement was taken out of context at a prior meeting. And what we will do is what we have always done is take the best information we have at the time and make the appropriate decisions based on what's best for all students. So the question about what someone said about we don't care about what's going on in other towns and cities, I didn't make that statement. I'm not quite sure who made that statement. But the reality is we're in charge of focused on what we need to do, what's best for our York students. And what one community does may have specific reasons why they do what they do. For example, there are schools, again, that are not in person. None of their kids are coming to school in person. Now, I'm sure those communities are taking heat because none of their kids are coming in person. There are some schools that are trying to get back in person as this virus is now taking off again. So each community is going to be unique. Each situation and each case is different. And that's just how it is. That's just the nature of the beast right now. You can't compare apples to apples in this environment.
Yeah, you know, I would add that, you know, it's not really a statement of don't care or more of the fact that we have to make our own decision. And it's not as, there really is, even the schools that have decided to have athletics, it's a close call. You know, the MPA came about a day away from saying that all fall sports were off. In fact, that's the information we were getting. And at the 24th hour, that's the right way to say it, the state got involved and changed their mind, and it was kind of a surprise. You know, we all as athletic directors had kind of doom and gloom there for a while. You know, 100% thought that was going to be the call because they were sticking to guidelines we couldn't reach. I'd also say that, you know, I know 100% that this situation is going to continue to evolve. When we first started talking about what our fall guidelines would be, and that was coordinated practices, that was without the knowledge of what was going to happen in school. There's many people that thought we'd be in 2 weeks of school and be shutting it down. The good news is we really haven't seen, you know, really anywhere in Maine spread within the schools. We're getting cases that are coming up from outside the school, and that's good. That's going to help the case moving forward to trying to evolve into more activities because we're not seeing a positive case turn in, you know, a kid go to a classroom with 20 other kids and now 19 of those kids have COVID. We're just not seeing the spread within the schools. Teams aren't seeing it in the athletic on the field. So hopefully that leads us to being more confident that, you know, we can do more activities and it's still safe. But it's just, this is all unknown. I think that's been the biggest challenge and the reason why every school district has to make their own decision.
So a third question from John Gennaro is, are we considering preventative testing incorporated into the YSD procedures? And Mr. Gennaro explained that preventative testing to him meant having students tested multiple times, maybe multiple times a week, so that we had a sense that they were negative and not asymptomatic positive, so that we'd be able to have more confidence in the gameplay without fear of spreading the disease.
I will be addressing that with our committee on Thursday. There's a lot of folks I need to bring into that decision. The question is going to be, what tests are we going to use? I know there's a push for rapid tests that's out there, and I'm not sure that test itself is an adequate test. There's a lot of false negatives associated with that test. So I'm going to rely upon some of our medical people to give me input on that. I'm not an expert in testing, and I certainly will ask it of the committee, and we'll explore that.
Yeah, and I would say that wasn't really, you know, even a conversation when we made fall plans. You know, this has kind of been more of a newer thing. John had emailed me a little while ago about this possibility that it was, you know, things were coming out, more rapid tests. So, you know, I think it's a conversation moving forward for winter and spring sports. So,
I have another question for you. It comes from Meg Goldberg, and she has a couple of them. And I'm just going to give you the first one so I can listen to the next one. She wants to know what the York School Department is doing to supplement students' learning, learning with the things that are typically learned by their interactions in athletic activities and sports and things like that. So what are we doing to kind of backfill for that experience for students?
Well, you know, I would say we're still having those interactions. I think there's been some tie into games, you know, defining a season. But we are having the practices after school. They're certainly not 5 days a week, and I, you know, hope we get to that point. But, you know, our kids are spending time with coaches, and even when we're in the virtual mode, our coaches went above and beyond to continue to have ways to connect with the students. You know, just going out there and talking to the students. I said earlier, I know they would love more, but we're providing everything that we can provide. You know, same thing in the classroom. Kids are getting the two face-to-face days. And, you know, obviously they were getting more out of their educational experience when it was five face-to-face days. And so there is some loss there. And you can't necessarily make up for all that loss, but you know, we're doing whatever we can to offer what we can.
So another question that Meg has for us is, what about kids who aspire to play sports in college? What advice do we have for those students to navigate the college recruiting process? And have we heard anything from recruiters or from colleges, or do we know resources that students can go to get information about how to navigate that challenge?
So far, I haven't seen much change in that area. You know, I was talking to our football coach the other day, and he said 3 or 4 kids that have had multiple offers. You know, coaches college coaches have really moved to more of a virtual way of getting all the kids long ago. But, I get emails of list of kids that colleges want to come in and see. You know, they're not coming in and see anymore, but, you know, they're looking for contacts for those students to get a hold of them. So I'm getting just as many emails as I did the year before and before COVID. It seems like, you know, that process is still moving smoothly. I do think that we do have a need to maybe provide some kind of, you know, what's new for students and what should they do. And that's something I'm going to work on and try to put together. It's not a resource that's out there because this is all new for everyone. So it's creating something from scratch. But I think it's a great idea, and I'm thankful for that suggestion.
I don't have any more questions yet from folks, but they can send in a question, share a question with us by phoning 363-3403 extension 10016, where you'll leave a message and it will be relayed.
Looking at other information as we wait for other questions to come in, Do we want to talk about things we talked about today, the possibility of doing some recognition?
Yeah. So, you know, as I've said, and I'll continue to say, we're going to try to move, forward with events as we feel we can. The last 2 weeks of athletic events, the practices outside have gone well. Our students have, they're following the guidelines, they're wearing the mask. We haven't seen in the classroom or in the field a student test positive and then that result in more, positive tests. It's just not spreading. So that's good. What we talked about today is moving forward with a plan to recognize our seniors and have a senior night event. And we're going to try to make that happen quickly, probably early next week. And that senior night event would include seniors from both cohorts because we want them to be together. But at the same time, we're going to put in some safety measures to, kind of like with the cross country meet, where we try to avoid any unnecessary risks and still give them an opportunity to get together and celebrate. And, for the athletes, senior night is maybe up there or for some a bigger priority than graduation. So I'm thankful that we're finding a way to make that happen. More information will come on that.
Yeah, I just wanted the folks that are watching to know that I created, I think it was 2 years ago now, an athletic activities advisory group. It's composed of Jeff and Emily Castelline and a couple of the principals. I have a couple of school committee members on there, middle school representation. And we've been meeting quite a bit to look at, look at different opportunities we can provide. One of the things we did discuss today was offering a senior night for athletes. So we're excited about that. And again, Jeff said there's more to come. We're talking about that this afternoon and information will be forthcoming. So, last year, at the end of last school year, it was really difficult in terms of, working through our graduation. And we put a lot of time and effort into that. And I want to thank Kyle Francis and his staff. We ended up having graduation over period of 2 days, but to me it was quite important and it was quite successful and could see that kids were pleased by that, and we're hoping to do the same for our athletes for the fall season in terms of bringing them together with their parents to give them some acknowledgement and let them know that we care about them and that we know it's been difficult for them and just want to take an opportunity to thank them and their families for what they've done over the years. And so hopefully I think that's going to be able to be done and pulled off in a safe way.
I have another couple of questions for you. Tom Trafton has called in and he's posed two questions. One, he wants to know if we have considered or if it might be possible for us to, he knows that we're in a cohorted cohorts at the high school. And he wonders whether or not it would be possible to alternate weeks to be able to put in place a Wednesday practice to be able to increase the kind of the touch time, if you will, during practices while still maintaining the cohort.
I think that, yeah, go ahead, Jeff. Yep.
Yeah, it's been talked about. And I think, with the notice of, hey, you're green and we got going pretty quick. The challenges we face, right now is we have the field space maxed out. We have our coaches pretty maxed out if we're considering, I'm asking them to do a lot and keep track of a lot of guidelines. And then we have daylight maxed out. I mean, it's dark at 4:30. We can't move kids to bog like we would have done in past years. Transportation is a major hurdle. Right now I think where we're at with the 2 weeks left, we're here, but certainly, I absolutely will be, pushing and trying to support having the five practices a week. I think we got to get back to that. It's just this, usually we would not really be that far into November. We wouldn't be dealing with this, it being so dark and just the challenges of having, really trying to keep our numbers down and still only having the same number of coaches. So I think all those hurdles can be overcome, just not for the 2 weeks we have left for the fall.
And the other question that Tom had for us was, have we given any consideration in the spirit of getting kids together to do things outside, have we considered cornhole tournaments or dodgeball tournaments or ping pong matches where this is, again, it's just a to get kids together.
I could take it if you want.
Take that one, Carl.
There are a couple of things I wanted to make sure we talked about today, and that is one of them, that we want to start having some intramural activities, something after school, something outside, to following safety guidelines. We understand that athletics are extremely important, but we also understand that not everybody participates in athletics. And we want to offer things to all of our students, opportunities for all of our kids who deserve that. And I had a conversation today about what that might look like. We've identified an individual who might lead us in intramural activities. We've looked at funding for that. I'd say, yes, that's in the works, definitely. And probably look at starting after the fall athletics. Complete at the end of the next week, we'd kick right into some type of intramural participation. So, Tom, I hear you loud and clear, and we support that idea.
Well, Tom, I want to take you up on the cornhole idea. I think that's an awesome idea. I'm a big cornhole fan myself. And if we can make arrangements for that, I think that'd be great. I think students could even play cornhole out in the winter. You know, they bundle up and, you know, get outside and throw a few beanbags to you know, compete in that particular type of activity. So I've talked to the middle school principal and the high school principal, Carl, about using some of our resources to, again, offer some of these other activities. And it's just a matter of Carl working with others to put that in place. So I support that 100%.
I have another question for us. This one's from Kim Orso, and she wants to know if we could please tell the community what to expect. I don't know if you can do it tonight, but can you tell the community what the green and yellow plans look like for both winter and spring so that they will know what to expect when MPA announces its plan? And I'll add my own question, which is what do we know about the MPA's plan and the timeline for that?
I'm wondering if the green and yellow comment is for us, you know, locally and not the MPA, but I'll start with the MPA. It's really hard. You know, we certainly have been in talks a lot about winter. You know, the last 2 weeks we have picked up on the conversation about, you know, winter possibilities. So we've talked about if we're in the same scenario as we are right now in the fall, if our plan doesn't change, then we'll be looking to provide whatever activities we can outside. And you know, that could be basketball outside, that could be hockey outside. I mean, that is one of the scenarios we might find ourselves in, especially if all of this takes a negative turn. And we see, you know, more cases or that we stay in yellow. The state right now just says if we're in yellow, athletic activities cannot happen. I'm really hopeful they'll reconsider that a little bit, just because I think we can provide safe activities even when we're in yellow. It's something the Western Maine Conference, you know, I'm going to try to get us to write something as a conference, just to support the idea that we can still do some activities in yellow. And that's really just my personal take there. The MPA hasn't really given us any insight on what they'll allow in the winter. Their communications have been pretty vague on details, other than to say that they're going to reconvene and make a decision possibly for a January start. And that's what we're dealing with. You know, I think no matter what, we're going to provide some sort of activities and look to do that if we're allowed to do so and push, you know, to do something. I can't imagine a situation, or I don't want to, or we have nothing offered after school. I'd like to avoid that. But again, if we're in yellow and the state just says we can't do anything in yellow, then we're kind of at a stalemate there.
Jeff, when would the winter season start?
We usually would start middle of November. So we'd be looking at, just about when we're saying fall is going to end, we'd be starting. So they've already decided that's not going to happen. It's going to be January at best, but really, really nothing beyond that. I think, you know, they're still in talks with the state. The indoor concerns are there for the state. And, you know, things like USM, which is our indoor track facility, has already come out and said that, you know, high schools won't be able to use their facility. So there's going to be unique hurdles throughout the winter, and we'll try to get through them the best we can.
So, Jeff, this is I have three new questions for you. The first one, I think, is one that you kind of partially just addressed, and that is, when do we anticipate some news about next steps from MPA? You said that they've said nothing, certainly nothing, until sometime in January, but when should we expect to hear from them?
Yeah, I would say absolutely in the middle of December, early December. I think they would want to avoid the last minute nature of the fall. And I imagine that's why they moved to January as a start date, to give them more time. You know, they're having to work with the state, and that's you get two organizations, the state and the MPA, trying to come together to figure out what's best for the kids and the communities. It does take a little time. So there is no, MPA did not give us like, hey, you'll hear from us at this point. And that traditionally has been the way this has all been. We kind of get notified when they have new information for us.
Okay, so that question was posed to us by Michelle Soares, and she also wants to know if we have entertained the idea, considered the notion of having sports teams be in the same cohort. So all the wrestling team or all the hockey team be in cohort A, or the girls basketball team be in cohort B, that sort of thing.
I think that's been considered. Maybe the logistics of that, I think, is where you get into trouble, because, you know, kids either move from one sport to the other, or things drastically change between seasons, and there's not much of a time between some seasons. I don't know if Carl has more insight on that, but I know I didn't really have much to do with making the school day cohorts. I don't know what the challenges are there.
We balanced it. You know, the cohorts were based on balance. And sections and teacher sections and course offerings were based on the information that we had. And, that's how the system was built. And, I think it'd be problematic to have a landslide of one way or the other. I mean, we could consider it for the future, but we really haven't looked too deeply into that based on the numbers that we have in place now. And the balance that is absolutely required for our courses and the sections of our courses. We could take a look at it.
Yeah. So Carl, you're saying, if you move 10 students and, or 5 students get moved from an English class to another day, that English class might not be provided, or, it just creates balance conflicts, it sounds like.
Yeah, absolutely. Teachers already have, anywhere from 14 to 22 or 3 students in a class, switch it to a different day. You have to have room for those students to fit in. So it's a huge puzzle. And, I don't want to say I'm not going to consider it. I will, but the workload of the teachers right now is already tremendous on what we're asking teachers to do. And the last thing I want to do is put an increased burden on the teachers, what we're already asking them to do. I know it's important for kids, but that'd kind of be a last resort thing for me, I think, in this scenario. But I can look at it.
And maybe another challenge is that, I don't know if everyone knows the numbers, but in any given season, usually about half our students are athletes. So we're not talking about just moving a few students. It would be quite a bit of moving probably. But, maybe we look at it and, somehow, we get lucky and there's only a few students you're moving, but I have a feeling that would be a pretty big challenge, but worth looking into. Thank you.
I have two more questions for you. The first one is from Kelly Clayton, who asks whether or not the school district has considered a gap season for fall sports to be able to have some play time in the spring.
Yeah. One of the things that you're talking, I think the example would be having football in the spring, and that idea was bounced around, and I haven't heard too much more from the MPA on that. I'm in favor of that. I'm in favor of having a gap season. You know, then it's going to make it difficult for those players that play football and may play spring sports as well. But I'm open to that idea, moving some of these sports into the spring. And so I still haven't heard back from the MPA. Some of the superintendents have been discussing that and trying to get some answers on that one, particularly that and some other sports like field hockey. One thing I posed to some of the superintendents in York County is perhaps we just work as a county and not rely upon the MPA rules, and then we work on our own, you know, field of play, so to speak, when it comes to implementing the standard. So that had some interest. I'm still going to be pursuing that with other superintendents, meaning that we would work out our own arrangements as a county rather than, you know, rely upon the MPA. But there's some in favor of that, some not in favor of that. But it's just trying to think outside the box here and come up with a way to make it work for York County.
And in a normal year, and I guess the word normal is probably appropriate, you know, there wouldn't be any ability to go outside of what the MPA is offering. So, and I still don't know if that's an option. There could be, you know, if we say, hey, we're going to do field hockey in May and MPA says no, there could be sanctioning penalties there. You know, there could be something there. And we certainly need other schools to be on board. So, you know, if we really want to have something that's engaging for our students, we would want to have, you know, other schools playing these sports as well. So I think, Lou, the concept of getting the whole county involved would be absolutely essential. Other than that, we'd just be practicing by ourselves.
Correct. Sayward posed has a question for us also. She noted that you were talking about the fact that transportation is a big hurdle for us using space at town fields like a bog, and want to know if there has been a survey sent to families to see who's able and willing to transport their students specific to athletics, not just generally, because as we know, the families have been overwhelmingly supportive of transporting their students to school and taking the pressure off of transportation to and from schools and the distancing that we need to do on buses.
Carrie, I'm certainly you know, willing to look into that. Our biggest concern has been, and again, we probably could have asked the survey and figured that out, but if we have a large amount of students that can't do that, you know, the equity of that. But, you know, I know with golf, when we only had 6 or 7 students involved, golf practice has to happen on a golf course. So that became a requirement of golf. Like you will have to be able to transport yourself to the golf course. And that happened. I don't think we lost any students there. So I think that's a consideration we should be making, you know, going forward. Yeah, the availability of bog field hasn't always been the same. And that's another challenge as kind of everyone's activities have shifted in a different direction. But I think looking into the availability of other town fields and looking into the idea of students traveling by themselves or having parents bring them there is a good one.
I have a follow-up. Sorry, did you want to add something? I didn't mean to step on. Okay. Just trying to keep the questions coming. I have a follow-up from Kim Orso. She said that she's interested in if we get a green designation by spring, you know, fingers crossed on all of our parts that happens. What details aside from the implementation of the safety guidelines, the six guidelines that we need to meet, what other kinds of details can you share with us? For example, have we given thought to what the sidelines would look like? Would people be able to attend, or have we considered streaming games so that folks could see games? Have we kind of gotten out that far? Do we have any details that we can share about that sort of thing? Yeah. And I'm going to add to Kim's question, what have we learned about the events that we've been able to hold in the practices that would help to inform that?
Great question. Actually, the MPA and the state really handle that all for us. So the schools that are having events, there are guidelines on what the bench looks like. Pretty much the whole state, I think every conference that I'm involved with has agreed to not allow away spectators, but to allow home schools to make their own decision about spectators. And they're not really free to make their own decision because, you know, by the state of Maine, we have to stick to no more than 100 in it, you know, in an event. So if you have, let's say, 30 soccer boys on one team and 30 on the other, that gets you to 60, or sometimes it's 40 and 40 if it's JV and varsity. And so now you're cutting it pretty close. So what a lot of schools have done is they've said, hey, maybe senior parents can have two each, or maybe they change that the next week. But certainly the spectator side is very unique now. It's usually no away, and that's caused some conflict, you know, for some schools where away parents have shown up and been upset. But unfortunately that 100 capacity is, you know, and that could change though. I mean, come spring, that could be 200 or 500. You know, I think as the weather changes, that'll help our situation as well. But yeah, there'll most likely be some kind of restriction on spectators. There'll certainly be guidelines on, everything involved in the game, you know, what happens in the dugout, where people stand, how many can be in the dugout. They're going to go right down to the detail there. And what I've noticed or learned from what the activities we're providing now is our students and coaches will follow the guidelines we give them. I mean, it's, we don't know till we get to the situation, whether, you know, in week three or week four, we start to see less masks on and stuff, but you know, the students have been great with it. Our cross country event, they were great with it. Practices have been great. So, you know, I have no worries there. But as far as all the intricate part of gameplay and all the safety procedures, that'll all be given to us.
And I wanted to say, I think we certainly can videotape the games. I don't see why we couldn't do that. I also, if it's possible to live stream, we would look at live streaming if possible. And then we also can utilize YouTube. For taping the games. I think it's important that parents get a chance to see the kids play. That's another frustrating piece of this, is that, you know, we're limited to the number of people that can participate in a venue. And, you know, I understand the importance of holding games for kids. I get that. But the parents also want to see what's going on as well. So we would certainly entertain videotaping.
Yeah, Lou, and it's not too difficult to provide that these days. You know, I've talked to Patrick a little bit about it. You know, we haven't gone beyond talking about it at this point because we haven't gotten to that time. But, you know, most schools I know, if not maybe almost all of them, have found ways to share the game, just like we're sharing this meeting. I mean, it's not impossible.
So
I also wanted to point out.
Go ahead.
Sorry, Anita. Go ahead.
A follow-up comment, not a question, from Carrie Sayward is that she really urges the school department to survey about transportation, so that that by starting with the asking of that to parents, that we can better understand any equity concerns. So not a question, just a
yeah, comment. That's great.
Thank you, Carrie.
I was just going to mention that what we've learned, another point is just to support what Jeff was saying, that our students are really stepping up. They are really doing their best to follow guidelines. And I've been amazed when I watch them. They're doing a great job. So we've learned that the kids really want to participate and that they're doing their part.
And Carl, another point to make is that it's important that they're doing that, because, you know, the reward is the fact that we're not seeing, you know, at this point, we're just not in the classroom and on the field. We're not seeing the spread amongst the students in our schools, in our field. So, and really all of that has led to cross country being able to take a step forward and do their event. And now we're talking about doing a senior night event. So, you know, it all helps in us moving forward.
Any other questions, Anita?
I haven't had any questions for pushing 6 minutes now. So,
all right. Now a good time probably to talk about potential activities.
Yes.
Clubs. Yeah. So another tribute to our students, and the fact that we haven't seen things spreading within the building, and the fact that we need to support all students, that we want to look at participation in clubs and activities. At this point, we really had virtual only, but we understand if we're allowing our athletes to do that after school cohorted, that we wanted to offer the same thing for our students in clubs and activities. So we're finalizing plans now for our clubs and our activities to be able to meet after school in person by cohort. So that's another big thing we wanted to make sure that everybody heard tonight. We've heard you loud and clear. We agree that we want to make that happen. So tomorrow we'll be talking about those details with the school community on the opportunity for our clubs and organizations to meet in person after school. And it's likely going to look at two or three opportunities a day and just have people sign up for those specific time slots and designated locations. So we're happy to announce that to you tonight as well.
I'm looking at other things that we might want to mention. I guess I wanted to talk a little bit about just the frustration with sports in general for the fall season. I guess what was really frustrating for me is that I wish the guidelines had come out sooner than when they did, because it would have given us an opportunity to consider all aspects of this. And so the biggest frustration for me was that the guidelines for the fall anyway kept getting pushed out and pushed out and pushed out. I wish they had been solidified earlier on in August to at least give us the opportunity to move forward. And we've been kind of locked in there for a long period of time. And I'm just hoping that we don't have the winter guidelines continue to be pushed out and pushed out. That would be bothersome. And so I'm hoping that we'll get some guidelines here sooner than later. That's been the biggest frustration is just, we were trying to plan to open school, and we did a lot of hard work in July and August and working on what we thought were best plans for opening for school. And at the same time, we were waiting for the athletic guidance. And as Jeff had mentioned, once you have three agencies involved, it slows the process down. You have the MPA, you had the DOE, and you had the Maine CDC all coming together. And that was extremely frustrating for, I think, the local school districts. So
a couple more questions here. One is, these are from John Gennaro, they're follow-up questions. One, and I was listening to questions, so I don't know, I think you provided part of an answer that he'd like for you to explain a little bit more, but he wants to have some explanation about how using COVID tests that are 97% accurate would not enhance the self-screening process that we have. So that's the first part of his question. And he'd also like to know if we can, comment at all and explain the fact that Yarmouth and Freeport superintendents noted that there were approximately 400 students who successfully participated in fall sports this season.
Well, again, in terms of the testing question, I'm going to have to look into that. I don't know what test Mr. Gennaro is referring to. I can certainly, when I talk with our folks on the Health and Safety Committee, I'll certainly bring testing up and have that discussion. I can't speak for what's happening in the other two districts that were mentioned. I can speak for York. I'm not sure if those districts had an outbreak in one of their schools. I'm not sure the types of cases they've had over in that area. I can say that in York, we've had to deal with school closure. We've had to deal with closing a classroom down recently. We're on the fence right now whether or not if we have another case at the high school, we may have to shut the high school down. So again, I don't know what the unique issues are in those particular towns. And again, it's real difficult to compare apples to apples here when you're dealing with different circumstances in each school district that you're in. So can't speak for those towns, sorry.
John, I think it's at least a good number to know though, that we have had you know, athletics happen in Maine. And, you know, before the fall season started, like I said, the MPA was ready and the state was ready to say, we just can't do it. It's not safe enough. And you know, that's because they didn't know really what would happen once we started having athletic events. And we've seen a lot of success. We haven't seen spread. So I think that that helps build a case for trying to move forward, even for York. Even, you know, I know we've had some cases in more than other schools, but, you know, we're still not seeing the spread in the school. So we're controlling what we can control. And maybe that means we can use that information at some point, feel comfortable with moving forward. So I think that's great data to have. I'm super thankful that things have gone well for the teams that have participated, and that just means maybe we get closer to doing the same.
Right. A couple more questions and a couple more minutes here. Yeah. So the one first question that I'll pose to you is, can the administration speak to the kind of efforts that we have in place or are considering to monitor student mental health, knowing that mental health is, you know, that athletics can be very instrumental in positive mental health. So what are we doing to monitor mental health without having sports in combination with reduced in-person instruction? So how are we keeping tabs on that?
Carl, I'll let you speak to that, Carl. You're seeing it at the building level.
Yeah, we definitely are. Hearing that concern and sharing that concern with, you know, that what students really enjoy is that social element of being able to be together and celebrate together and, you know, enjoy their time together. And with reducing the amount of activities and athletic participation and offerings, social offerings, it definitely has had an impact. You know, we have mental health support in place at the building. When we have any situations that are presented to us, we make sure that the support is there for those students. We're trying to look for additional opportunities. We cited two opportunities that we unveiled tonight that we'd like to provide some more social opportunities. We're trying to do some Pride activities. You might have seen the recent activity we did in our Pride this week, and we'll continue to do that. So yeah, I don't have the magic wand answer, but what I can tell you is that we're aware and we're trying to promote and build some positive things into the things that we do every day at York High School. So we're very aware that mental health is something we need to pay attention to and continue to work hard to provide some things for students.
Great. Another question for us here. This one is, again, from Meg Goldberg. Rather than waiting for MPA to come out with guidance, would we consider drafting our own guidance for green, yellow, red, whatever scenarios, and being able to use that those drafts to be able to pivot from those?
Yeah, so we did that really for the fall. Unfortunately, the fall got shortened on us when yellow – you know, we had plans. Yellow was the plan to at least have the cohort practices. And if we got to green, be able to do more, especially if we already had weeks and weeks of cohort practices. Unfortunately, yellow at the last minute, and it really was at the last minute, turned into by the state full virtual. So I would say yes, all those plans can be made for the winter. But I would also say those plans can be almost thrown out the window sometimes, you know, when you suddenly get a different direction from the state. We don't have the luxury of saying, if the state says you can't do one thing, that we're going to do something different. But we're going to plan. I mean, that's actually been, you know, pretty much the whole summer was planning. You talk to any athletic director or superintendent or principal, it was plan after plan after plan, and then things would be edited or altered and then another plan would come out. So, certainly we're going to have our own plans. We're going to reevaluate everything we did in the fall, the things that worked well, things we think we need to do differently, and then make a plan for the winter. And then we'll do the same thing for the spring. So the plan for the winter doesn't necessarily mean it's going to match what we just did in the fall. I think we're going to be able to look at everything and come up with something.
We got one more minute here, Jeff. So I get one last question you. I'm sure that there are more that we could go on to, but for another date. Going forward, can this group commit to providing a weekly update to the public? This is from Brendan Hines. Can we provide a weekly update to the public regarding meetings and discussions that are being made by the group? Would it be possible to include one or two parents on the committees developing the solutions and making decisions regarding school athletics?
Now, I know Lou had talked about the possibility of some new committees, and I think really I lean on him on guidance on how often communications need to come out, and really, you know, some weeks we have a lot to share, and other weeks, maybe it's not athletics that was the big topic and something else has come up. So I think Lou can kind of maybe answer that one better than I can.
No, I think we need to form a committee looking at winter sports as well as spring. And I would, certainly have you lead that, Jeff, and Carl would be involved with that. I think we need to take a look at that. I will be working with the Health and Safety Committee, but I think we can certainly create a committee around athletics to seek some input from others. There's been some good ideas shared tonight. So I have no problem with that. It's interesting. I've been accused of communicating too much during the COVID pandemic, and I've been accused of not communicating enough. So it depends on who you talk to. We've tried to, from the COVID point of view, in terms of keeping folks appraised of what's been going on, been doing that since last January. I'm fine-tuning the amount of information that's going to come out. If you look at our website, you'll see all the communication that has been sent out. But, some folks are saying I'm saying too much. Other folks are saying, you're not saying enough. So I'm damned if I do and damned if I don't. But in terms of the athletic piece of it, we can certainly look at bringing in some folks that want to participate in it and see what we're up against in terms of decisions that we have to make. So I have no problem with that. And that's what I had mentioned that to you earlier, I think today, Jeff, about the possibility of getting a group together to look at, the winter and also the spring season. So,
yeah, I think parents and coaches can add some value to that. And as far as the weekly communications, it does get tough, and there does have to be a balance because, oftentimes a plan 1 week can play – takes a complete U-turn out of our control the next week. So I know in the summertime, I can imagine sometimes it gets frustrating to have one plan and it changed. And, so sometimes, I can imagine most of the time the weekly communications would be a little bit much, especially in the winter with now we're kind of in the wait for the MPA. But certainly we've probably been, trying to get out. We have been getting out information as we have it. I think we're going to continue to try to do that. And really good idea about the committee you just talked about earlier today. I think coaches and some parents, and of course we need to have some experts in that group too. So medical experts.
Okay. So I think we're going to say goodbye now. Time to go get some dinner for me. And I want to thank everyone who participated tonight. Thank you for the questions. And like we said, we're going to take it one day at a time and continue to make the best decisions we can based on the information we have that looks at, protecting everyone, health and safety of all our students and staff. And as I said earlier, we're not ruling out activities for the winter. We're not ruling out activities for the spring, and we're certainly not waiting for herd immunity, and we're certainly not waiting for a comprehensive vaccine. So with that said, we'll call it a night. And again, thank you, everyone. And thank you, Anita, for fielding the questions. Thank you, Carl and Jeff, for being here, and Patrick Robb behind the scenes. So with that, take care, everyone. Have a good night. Stay healthy. Bye-bye.